各位傳媒朋友早晨，多謝大家今朝嚟呢個記者會。稍後行政長官咧會先向大家發言，之後接受大家提問。因為疫情關係，請大家喺記者會入邊咧係盡量保持距離。我哋而家會先請行政長官向大家發言。
各位傳媒朋友、各位香港市民，早晨嚇。或者在我簡單講講嚟緊嘅第七屆立法會選舉之前咧，我想借今日嘅機會，再次向好多朋友、同事同埋市民咧，喺我受傷期間送上嘅祝福希望我早日康復咧，係表示衷心嘅感謝嚇。現在基本上工作都是一切如常噶啦，但係當然行動上有啲唔方便，咁所以譬如今日咧。我冇辦法可以用筆記錄住大家的提問，所以請大家咧就係短問短答。我會容許或者即係阿神會俾大家多啲提問嘅機會，但係希望每一位嘅記者咧都係只係問一個嘅問題嚇。就去到呢個星期尾咧，就第六屆嘅立法會咧將會係休會。換句話說咧，亦都係進入咗。換屆立法會換屆選舉的提名期了，就由10月30日開始，一共是兩個禮拜。這一場的選舉是非常重要的，是在由中央作出一個決定，修訂了基本法附件一和附件二之後的三場的選舉裏面的第二場，涉及的範圍亦都是最廣泛，選民的人數亦都是最多的。在完善了選舉制度之下的香港特別行政區的立法會將是擴大到由現在的70席去到90席，今天的兩個板塊，即是說功能組別和地區直選，就增加到包括有選舉委員會的推選或者是選出的40位立法會議員的第三板塊。換句話說，參政的機會呢是比往時呢是更加多，而隨著香港回到一國兩制的正確軌道，我們相信這一套的選舉制度呢不但只能夠確保愛國者治港，亦都是可以切實提升特區的管治效能。當然特區的管治效能，特區政府呢是第一的責任人，但是立法機關同樣是在香港特別行政區的政治體制裏面擔負非常重要的責任，無論是在制定修訂的本地的立法，以至到去撥款方面質詢政府、監察政府的工作。譬如在第六屆立法會延任了過去一年的期間，大家就看到一個理性務實蔓延住配合特區政府施政，但同時監察特區政府工作的立法會咧，係做出了非常之好的成績。無論在法例的通過或者係撥款的數量嘅增加咧，都係可以講咧係對社會非常之有交代。正如內務委員會主席李慧瓊所講，係交出了一份亮麗的成績表。所以當然作為行政長官，我希望由明年1月1日開始的第七屆的立法會都繼續抱持這種的態度為社會做事。在這裡作一個呼籲，希望所有有志有抱負認為香港的管治效能是有提升的空間的朋友，都是積極參加這一場的立法會選舉。第二個關於選舉咧，就係香港歷嚟嘅選舉嘅公開嘅選舉咧，都能夠做到公平、公正、誠實同埋廉潔嘅。我相信嚟緊呢一場嘅立法會換屆選舉咧，亦都係同樣可以達至呢個嘅效果。但有一樣嘢係需要認真嚟到去處理同埋加以改善，就係有關於喺選舉過程進行裏邊，即係特別喺當天。投票日當天，如果係出現咗一啲嘅問題咧，亦都係應該加以處理同埋改善嘅。咁喺今年9月19日，即係第一場嘅選舉，關於選舉委員會界別分組嘅選舉裏邊，當日就真係出現咗唔少嘅問題，甚至可以講咧，每一個環節咧都係有一啲嘅失效啦 咁喺上個禮拜五，選管會咧亦都係提交咗，亦都公布咗一個非常之詳細嘅調查嘅報告。調查報告亦都係承認有多方面咧係可以改善嘅。咁我會責成選管會嚟到去切實咁去執行呢啲改善嘅工作，確保喺12月19日唔會再出現呢一啲令人到非常之關注嘅問題啦。選管會是獨立來到去安排一場的選舉，但是選管會都要向行政長官負責的，所以我亦都是有這個要求，要求選管會在選舉事務處的配合之下要辦好接下來這一場立法會的換屆選舉。而政制及內地事務局作為那個選舉的政策的部門呢，亦都會全面配合選管會的工作，包括在需要找票站或者是其他的安排那方面。總的來說呢，在未來八個禮拜呢，我們就會進入去投票日。咁喺呢度亦都率先呼籲咧，所有已經登記嘅選民，亦都係應該踴躍去行使佢嘅公民權利，參與呢一場喺完善選舉制度之後嘅第一場嘅立法會換屆選舉。多謝大家。
而家係提問時間，請希望提問記者先舉手，嗌對之後咧，先介紹你嘅傳媒機構，然之後用我哋俾你嘅麥發問。因為行政長官難以記低記者嘅問題咧，請大家提問咧簡短，同埋咧每一記者一條問題，我哋爭取俾多啲記者提問。後面白色恤衫嗰位記者，
早晨，係林太 TVB。最近就有報道話，其實主管香港事務嘅京官夏寶龍咧，其實都南下嚟到深圳咁啊，會晤一啲香港人士，係咪要為未來4年立法會定調咧？唔該。
我唔可以評論，係呢個你都講都係一個即係傳聞嚇。咁但係中央最關心嘅咧，我相信就係既然係做咗呢個咁重大嘅舉措。由人大作咗個決定，再由全國人大常委會嚟到去修訂咗基本法附件一、附件二，交由香港特別行政區咧本地立法，完成咗呢啲工作之後，中央當然會係好關注，亦都好關心喺落實呢一套完善選舉過程裏邊咧，係咪都係唔會出現有問題啦？咁但係任何嘅選舉咧。公開的選舉都要做到公平公正、誠實和廉潔，所以我相信中央的如果是關心都是這個出發點。
下一條題目，右手邊靠中間白色衫位，是，麻煩。
林太你好，香港電台，首先就想問一下，即係都有報道引述消息咧，就話政府會極力爭取在12月之前就首階段通關啊。想問一下，即係呢個消息係咪都屬實啦？係咪有呢個計劃啦？嚟緊幾時同內地即係開第二次嘅專家對接會議咧？第二個問題就係
差唔多啦，唔該，唔該 ，thank you。
我哋特區政府從來都係非常之重視。盡快能夠讓香港的居民咧可以免檢疫回到內地，因為已經是一段很長的時間，亦都為香港市民帶來了很多經濟啊、民生啊，甚至係家庭要團聚啊等等的問題。咁所以呢啲嘅努力咧，從來都冇鬆懈嘅嚇。咁但係你話而家嘅目標係幾時咧？我的目標是越早越好。不過我必須要重申咧，如果能夠達至通關咧，都係一個有序係由小到大嘅通關嘅情況。換句話說咧，個規模喺開初嘅時候咧係會係好細嘅嚇，係會有配額嘅，唔係回復翻去疫情之前咧，我哋有六七個口岸，大家可以隨便咧就係過去內地嚇。所以呢個目標咧越早越好，所以並冇話係12月某一日之前咧係要達至到通關啊。好啦，咁第二樣嘢咧就而家個磋商嘅工作去到咩嘅階段咧？我早前都同大家通報過噶啦。我哋喺疫情真係差唔多完全受控，本地清零咗一段相當長嘅日子之後。就向中央提出了很具體的要求和建議，中央的相關的部門呢也都是跟我們對接了一次，也都是之後再回饋了意見， 咁我哋就住中央提出點樣可以令到香港嘅防疫工作同內地較為一致，令到兩地嘅即係通關咧係比較容易可以處理咧，我哋亦都再次提交咗我哋嘅意見，而呢啲意見咧係會落實執行嚇。咁啊，大家會往後會見到方方面面咧，我哋都會係加緊呢啲防疫嘅措施，譬如最近我哋話。大家入嚟呢個政府大樓或者所有嘅政府處所咧，都要係用呢個安心出行，就係方便日後如果有感染個案咧，可以更加容易可以追蹤到一啲緊密嘅接觸者。我哋亦都會稍後公布咧，以往喺舊年年初就住海外或者係內地進入本港免檢疫，係一啲所謂嘅豁免嘅群組，大部分嘅豁免群組咧亦都會取消嚇。只係剩翻啲非常有緊急必要性同香港日常運作有關嘅人咧，譬如一啲跨境嘅貨車司機咧，仍然可以係免檢疫咁樣嚟到係喺往來兩地。咁所以呢啲嘅措施咧，我哋成熟一項就會推一項，嚟到達至希望中央可以更加有信心咧，俾我哋可以通關嚇。咁但係第二次嘅對接會暫時係冇時間嘅。有時間的時候，我們一定會通知大家。
下一條問題。Gentlemen here, please.
Good morning, Mrs. Lam, Hong Kong Free Press. Two short questions.
One question, please.
Amnesty International has followed Human Rights Watch in leaving the city, citing the security law crackdown. What's your response, please?
Well, since the enactment of the National Security Law, different associations and various individuals have explained or justified their actions on the basis of a National Security Law. But there is no way that one could prove that this is exactly the reason for their taking such a decision. So similarly, I could not comment.On this explanation given by an organization about their departure from Hong Kong. But what I could say here is under basic law, I think it's Article 27, the freedom of association, the freedom of assembly, like the freedom of speech and so on, are being guaranteed. So no organization should be worried about their legitimate operations in Hong Kong, but it has to be done in accordance with the law. Now, the third point I want to make is when people try to allege and accuse the national security law for posing threats or intimidation on people, one should read very carefully the national security law, particularly the article which says that we would, at the same time,safeguard the rights and individuals enjoyed by people under the Bill of Rights Ordinance and also the various clauses in the international covenants as applied to Hong Kong. But the National Security Law's primary objectives is not just to arrest people and punish people. It also has a very laudable objective to prevent and suppress. So if there are individuals, organizations that have been using Hong Kongto spread, news or to engage in activities that they are worried because these activities are sort of undermining the national security of Hong Kong, then of course they would need to be worried because the national security law is not just about arresting people who have committed a crime. It is also about trying to prevent and suppress the activities which will have that impact of undermining national security. But on the other hand, may I draw your attention to some facts. Now, I said I could not comment on speculations or excuses, but I could show you the facts. The facts is, according to the latest survey by the Census and Statistics Department and Invest Hong Kong, as at June this year,the number of overseas and mainland companies that have set up offices, headquarters in Hong Kong has not reduced. In fact, it was another record-breaking number of over 9,000 such overseas and mainland companies that have established in Hong Kong. And I could also show you the fact that some important legal organizations at the regional or international level have also established offices in Hong Kong in a legal hub set up by the Department of Justice. And last week, we have a very important worldwide maritime conference in Hong Kong, and this International Council of Shipping, the first office outside of a headquarters, is set up in Hong Kong. So these are the facts which will give you the confidence that the national security law has not prevented or horrified people from doing their legitimate business in Hong Kong.
下一條, 這位男記者,
Mrs. Lam, I have a question about Hong Kong's international reputation as a free and open city. Of course, just now you mentioned there are some good achievements. I think no one would dispute that. But because of the border restrictions, many foreign business leaders, including the CEO of a Financial Markets Association, said going forward, Hong Kong's status as an international financial center is increasingly at risk. And also at the same time, the government is launching this reform of the legal aid system. And some people said it go against the basic laws guarantee that people are free to choose their own representation. So I just want to ask you, especially because Hong Kong has made the achievement that you explained just now, going forward, are you concerned that this situation could change for the worse? Thank you.
A simple answer is I'm not concerned. As you have realized since the announcement of the 2021 policy address on the 6th of October, I've been speaking on many, many public occasions and taking various interviews of the media. And the recurring theme in what I have said on those occasions is I'm full of confidence about Hong Kong's future. Because one, Hong Kong is back on the right track of one country, two systems. There need not be the usual worries of Hong Kong becoming a gaping hole in national security. Secondly, is we have an improved electoral system which will return politicians or legislative council members who are patriotic. So they will not do anything to endanger national security. They could still ask us to be accountable for the things we do. They could still refuse to support our policies and legislation. But ultimately, all these are done in the best interests of Hong Kong. And thirdly, is one has seen how a more rational legislative council has managed to do a lot of good things for the people of Hong Kong, including some very important legislation, such as allowing non-locally trained doctors to come to Hong Kong in order to reduce the waiting time and to improve Hong Kong's healthcare system. So all these are the basis of my confidence going forward, let alone the staunch support of the central people's government as reflected in the 14th five-year plan, the Qianhai plan, the Guangdong, Hong Kong, Macau, Greater Bay Area outline development plan. So all these are very positive elements that any corporation, whether local, mainland, or overseas, will definitely take into account in deciding whether they want to set up an office or do business in Hong Kong. Now, since you mentioned the legal aid review, which I understand will be discussed in the Legislative Council panel, the AJLS panel this afternoon, this review was prompted by me in answering a question in Legislative Council in June this year. I am very appreciative of the Chief Secretary for Administration and the Director of Legal Aid for completing this exercise within a matter of a few months and come up with a package of very sensible, pragmatic, and balanced proposals, whether in offering criminal legal aid or civil legal aid, as well as legal aid in respect of judicial review cases. So as set in the review's objectives, one is to prevent the monopoly of legal aid cases by a small group of lawyers, barristers and solicitors together. Secondly, is to enhance the management, the case management of legally aided cases. And third is to enhance the transparency of the entire legal aid system. And I don't think anybody would dispute these are very good objectives, and hence the package has been approved or endorsed by the Legal Aid Services Council. And I'm sure in this afternoon's legal panel, it will also be very positively received by members of the Legislative Council. Now, the last point about travel without restrictions, this is a very difficult subject. As I have explained on many occasions, we are caught in a sort of a dilemma, because in order to resume some quarantine-free travel with the mainland, we have to ensure that our anti-COVID-19 practices are more in line with the mainland practices, so that the mainland authorities will have the level of confidence to enable Hong Kong people to go into the mainland without being subject to the 14-day plus 7-day quarantine. And in the anti-COVID-19 strategy, controlling the import of possible cases is a very important part of that strategy. So if Hong Kong were to loosen the border controls for people arriving from overseas, or adopt what other countries have done, so-called to live with the COVID-19 virus, then the chances of resuming travel with the mainland will be reduced. It is a very simple hypothesis. And so I can only say to those representing the financial sector that we have to look at it in context. The contest is Hong Kong's primary advantage lies in being the gateway to the mainland of China. If businesses established in Hong Kong could not go into the mainland, I think it will significantly reduce the attraction of Hong Kong as an international business hub and an international financial center. So at the moment, the Hong Kong SAR government's strategy is to try to work very hard to resume some travel with the mainland, especially for the business people. And then if the global situation stabilizes, if confirmed cases in the countries where people want to come to Hong Kong come down, then of course we will put them not in the Group A countries, subject to 21 days. They will come Group B with 14 days after full vaccination, or better still, maybe they could come down to the Group C with only a 7-day quarantine, which I understand will sort of provide much relief to the financial sector. But the current situation is we have not yet reached that stage, whether locally with the mainland or globally. 多謝大家。
林太在香港嗎？是不是犯法的？